hired there by profession. So I got into this job. When I got into this job, I was the only first software engineer. So all of my peers now are scientists, researchers. So as I move through this talk, keep in mind that this is, you can think of this as an introduction to our program from a software developer's point of view. So this is Tiwata. So she was launched April last year, right? Let's see. So April last year, she's the very first Microsatellite to be built and designed by Philippine. Its main purpose is to take pictures of the Earth. So it's an Earth observation satellite, so it points down towards the stars. This is one of the first images it was able to take. This is of Isabella. So, to introduce our program, this is our program is called the Philippine Microsatellite Program, or PHL Microsat. It's a collaborative effort between PDLiman, POST, and two partner universities from Japan, Kobu and Hokkaido University. So we actually sent a couple of students to do their masters there. At the same time, build the satellite. And also, of course, aside from the people we've sent to Japan, we have the local teams here, which I am part of. So we are stationed here in mostly. Talk about each of them later. So the project is divided into five components. So the first one is the people in charge of building the actual satellite. So these are the hardware guys. It's not us. So these are electric engineers from UP, the UP IEEE Institute. IEEE Institute. So these are engineers, so they are the ones who take care of designing the hardware, do the testing, and of course, firmware, embedded systems, basically. The second group are the people who maintain and set up the ground receiving station. So this is the group from UST's Advanced Science and Technology Institute. So they are the ones who control the antenna, man the ground station. Their office is also located here. That was also not us. For the third one, are the people who are in charge of the calibration of the instruments. So these are the ones who specialize in validating and calibrating optical systems and cameras. So since these things are not the images that the satellite will be used in science, so it is important that all of the bands used by the satellite is accurately calibrated. This is also not us. It's from a department at the UP's Field and Engineering Department. Department of Field and Engineering. And the fourth one are the people who are in charge of developing end products. So from the images that are produced by the satellite, they are responsible for doing products that can be used by decision makers. So I will just give examples later. So this is also not us. These are scientists from UP IESM. So and then the fifth one is our team. So we are the devs. We also come from the UP's Department of Geodetic Engineering. Our team is called the Data Processing and Distribution. We are composed of a team of geodetic engineers, physicists, and people like me, devs, developers. So, to make our discussion later smooth, I would like to show you a short overview of the pipeline, the story of an image that comes from the satellite up to the site where we distribute them to the public. It starts off here, the actual satellite. So it captures images, it orbits around the Earth very fast. So that maybe for an average of 4 times per day above the Philippines. So, and then there's this. It's the ground receiving station. That's the antenna behind me. So I'm a software engineer. I don't know anything about hardware. So what you're looking at here is a software engineer looking out on hardware that he doesn't know. Because that antenna, actually, this is one thing that fascinated me. That antenna, whenever the satellite passes over its range, it follows the satellite. So it waits for the satellite to rise there, and then it follows the truck until it sets on the other side. So it was very, very fascinating to watch, especially for me who had no idea at first. And then after the ground receiving station, we do some data pre-processing so that to make the images usable to the end users. So I'll explain those later. And then there's the distribution side. So our goal here, our goal for the images that satellite captures is to make it accessible to the public later. So this is where the distribution part comes in. So my team's responsibility is to build that distribution platform, and then with a platform for managing the images on all of the intermediate pre-processing steps that happens on the third step that I showed a while ago. I will just demo them later. And then there's the automating of data processing. So where does Python come in? So I divided the stuff that we do in Python into three categories. So the first one is obviously web applications. So this is the first one. We call it the data manager. So as I mentioned a while ago, the data processing part consists of many subparts. So these steps are currently being done by teams from different locations. So for this step, maybe this guy does it. For the next step, this guy does it, and so on. So this tool here is just a Django application that is just a Django application that helps. Helps with that collaborative effort. It's written in Django, and for the parts where we automate stuff, like thumbnail generation, we don't actually human intervention anymore. We use Celery. For maybe, I do not want to dwell on the details of Celery, but basically it's a tool for asynchronously processing data. And the next one, so I have mentioned also earlier, one of our responsibilities is to build the distribution platform. So this is the image browser. It's also built using Django. This is the tool that will be used by the public. Once it goes out of closed beta, anybody can sign up and access the data images. We use Jiao Django that allows us to do queries like this, where we can specify which areas we're interested in. The researchers can pick the images that are relevant to their studies. So that was web applications. The second category is image processing. Image processing. So one example of image processing is image classification. In this example, we use the image classification to identify the cloud cover of an area. So as the name suggests, it just tells us which parts of the image is a cloud, each pixel. So in this example, I don't think this is the final algorithm, but it's part of the research. And maybe for the people who are familiar with Jupyter notebooks, so this is how we collaborate. The research team usually writes stuff in Jupyter. So as dev team, the dev team can just easily reuse those functions. And so it's quite seamless. Why is cloud cover relevant? So in this example, we go back to our image browser. So we also give the end users, the researchers that use our images, an option to filter results by cloud cover. So if the researcher wants only images with like 5% cloud cover, you can indicate here. Because all of the images that we distribute will eventually have that particular metric. Okay. As I mentioned also, Jupyter Notebook, we use Rasterio to load, to read the image files. This Rasterio is just a library that was built by Mapbox. So they're a company that specializes in geospatial stuff. And of course, NumPy for the time. Another part of the pre-processing step is the georeferencing. So, what is this? Yeah. So, is anybody here familiar with georeferencing? So, yes. No. So basically, this is how it works. So the images that we capture from the satellite doesn't have any information on the latitude and longitude of each pixel. So the georeferencing step basically uses a master image that have known longitude and latitude values. And then we use feature matching. So we take 3 points from the master image, which is in this case it's the one on the left, on the right, sorry. On the right, it also takes 3 points from the slave, one on the left. And then we use a matching algorithm to match all of those 3 points. So as a result, you can use an algorithm to project the coordinates from the master image into the slave. So as a result, you can use come up with an image that is usable by geo people, so geospatial specialists. Yeah. So because without it, the images that the satellite takes will be just very expensive pixels. So in this case, because we were able to georeference the image, we can now merge it into different maps. We can stack them along with different data sources. For this, we also use Jupyter for the research part. And then once that is mature already, they send the code bring the code up to the dev team and operationalize. Also, Rasterio, OpenCV for some of the image processing stuff, and then NumPy for the map. There. So another metric or another product that the data processing step does is what we call the normalized difference vegetation index, or NDVI. This is basically a metric for measuring the measuring for identifying green healthy vegetation. So this is useful for people from the forestry sector, agriculture. Yeah. So we can use this actually automatically through the data processing step. And for this, just like the ones before, from the research team uses Jupyter Notebook extensively for stereo and by MATLAB libraries. For the third one, third category, is we have simulations. So the first simulation that we do is orbit tracking. We have built an orbit API that returns projected path, the projected path of the satellite. So we send it a time range, and it throws back the projections. Out of that orbit API, we were able to build this the satellite tracker tool, which is actually publicly available. I don't know if it's publicly available for us. So this one is live. So we can see that the satellite is currently about zero. Another use for the orbit API is this, the Diwata dashboard, which is a tool we made for internal operations managers. So the ones who manage the ground receiving station, this returns passes. So passes are the times when the satellite goes overhead above our GRS. So this is helpful for our ground operations team so that they can know when they have to be in the office, when they have to make sure that the computers are running smoothly, and they can watch the dish. And of course, when to expect new images to come. Because I forgot to mention earlier that aside from from receiving images, the ground receiving station, we also send commands. So this is also a chart for when we can send new commands to the satellite. So you can tell it to take photos 2 hours from now. Because we cannot communicate with the satellite all the time. So we can only communicate with it when it is within range. So that's one of the uses of Orbit API. By the way, Orbit API will be available to the public as well. So if you want to build mobile apps, this is actually not exclusive to Iwata. So if you want to draft the ISS or something, you can do that using our API. I will plug in our blog later where we can post tutorials on how to use it. Another simulation that we do is lifetime estimation. So here, as the name suggests, it computes when the satellite will finally enter the Earth's atmosphere and become a shooting star. Because the satellite, microsatellites in general, usually do not have thrusters. So it cannot compensate with Earth's gravity. So once it goes down, it will just go down. So in this projection, we still have until 2021. So one interesting fact that I learned also is that as time goes by, the images that the satellite produces will probably have higher resolution because it's closer to the Earth. So that's if it's not working. It's a good, very good middle ground between scientists and engineers because PyCon, as you know, has a very very easy learning curve for the scientists who do not want to spend much time learning how to code, and it's very ideal for scientists who don't want their language to get in the way of their science. And also for engineers, since libraries, a lot of libraries for science computations are already available in Python. So it's pretty easy to operationalize the stuff that the scientists need. So maybe we can think of it as a way to connect scientists to the people. So that was my very short talk. If you want to learn more about our program, so we have a blog. We plan on posting tech blogs actually. So this is from the team, our team. So this is not the PR side of the of Film Microsat. So this is probably a way to connect to the community. So we have also a website. So if you want to learn more about the program itself, there. Was it here? If you want to send me questions and stuff, through my email. And also, if you're interested in the stuff that I do myself, so this doesn't have to be. These aren't all Python stuff. So it can be me messing with hardware, failing. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you.